me welcome Professor Zaro. He'll be talking titled America Looking Forward.
I was just talking to some of my students. I know I have a big crowd like that. I should have charged you entry fee for $5. Anyway, thank you all for coming. I hope this will be a pleasant night. It's just a group of some couple of things maybe I've been thinking about the last couple of years of some of the issues and ideas I had in mind moving from engineering to banking to teaching. So a couple of ideas and trends going traveling around the world a lot. So I thought I'd put something together, and also a lot of reading coming out of it. So my topic today is what we have done before, what we have done wrong things. Maybe we did, maybe we're not. And I will try to answer some couple of questions for you. One of them, I want to know what the world we're living in. I just want you to take you to a tour outside Alamosa, Colorado, America, and see how's the world is going. And also I wanted to talk to you about some of the challenges which is I felt we in this country may have big problems with. So I call it the JIRC, and you're going to hear about the JIRC a lot throughout my presentation. And the last thing I wanted to talk about is what should we do? I feel like we lost kind of dominance in the world. So the world has been changing very, very fast. So how can we go back to it? I already made a mistake here, sorry. Okay, so anyway, 2 years in office, after 2 years in office, President Obama, he said this very famous state. They think we have not very good railroad system. China has a better one. China has a better supercomputers. And Singapore is having the largest airport. So to a certain extent, he is right. So I'm going to show you what he had in mind. 20 years ago, I felt that the U.S. have been losing. We were ahead of the game. When I immigrated to this country maybe 35, 37 years ago, I felt that there is a change happening, and keep traveling, I felt it more. For instance, you all know where is that building, is it? Where is this building?
Is that in Dubai?
Yeah, this is the tallest structure building in the world. This is actually called Burj Khalifa. Burj means tower. Khalifa is, you know, like the prince. Khalifa is the guy, like prince. This one is 2,700 foot, and it is 162, the largest structure we ever had. But it's interesting enough. Our imprint is there. This gentleman, Bill Baker, he's from a very famous Chicago company called Sun. And they are the one who designed this beautiful structure. So something we could be proud of. This company, Sun actually, they are the one who built the Sears Tower. They have a different name for it now. Yeah, see the Sears Tower there, where it's up. Of course, that's the Burj Khalifa we're talking about. Anybody knows this guy?
Carlos.
He's the richest man on earth.
Slim.
He's not very slim, but slim. Anyway, Mr. Slim is in the telecommunication business. It's very, very well known around the world. Again, 20 years ago, we were on top of this. I have to come with an announcement. Okay, and this is the largest plane. I even couldn't fit it in my slides. Anyway, it's Russian. It's okay. Don't worry about it. Okay. Well, refineries are very, very important because this petrochemical, and that's where cultures, you know, compete with each other. Well, this one is. I went there actually. It took me 1 hour. 45 minutes to go from one point A to B. This one is a big company in India called Reliance. Of course you know this. Yes. The city. This is the big city of the world, which is called London. London is a very interesting city because it's the most international city in the world because all the global business, international business do business there. when the people in the South Korea and Japan wakes up in the morning, work for 4 hours, and then the British will get up in the morning, then the British will work for 4 hours, the Asian will go home and sleep, the British still working, and the American wakes up and work at 8 o'clock. So they have the best of the two worlds. They have the world from Far East and America. So that's why they are international business. They call this the city, and this is a very famous building there. Okay. So anyway, anybody knows this one? Well, you know, hotels normally 5-star. Sometimes you see 6-star. This is 7-star hotel. Again, it's called Burj. They love the word Burj. Burj is mean tower, again, as you know. Al Arab, the Arabs, United Arab Emirates. Michael Jackson, before he died, used to live there, actually. It's $2,000 a night. It's not really bad. It's okay. This is the largest Ferris wheel. That's in Singapore. Okay, very, very famous. London has one, but no way. I think it's much, much smaller than this one. And this is the largest casinos and places. Mm-hmm. In a place called Macau. Anybody knows where Macau is? Mm-hmm. Well, Macau is actually used to be owned by the Portuguese, and it was like Hong Kong by the British. So this one was leased 99 years to the Portuguese. Now it has more business than Vegas, because the Chinese took over 10 years ago, and now they are bigger than Vegas. They have this hotel, Phoenician Hotel, if you've been in Vegas. This is 3 times our Phoenician hotels. So Macau Phoenician is almost 3 times Vegas. Hollywood anymore? This is Hollywood. They make more movies a year than us. Okay, that's an Indian. China is the big manufacturing company in the country of the world. China is a very interesting place. My speech is not about China, but I can't stop talking about it. I have a whole lecture about it. See, Chinese has kind of unfortunate somehow. They have three major, Beijing is here, of course, three major rivers, the Yellow River, Yangtze River, and Pearl River. So if you want to do business, you better do business in one of in these towns here. That's where most of the populations are. The more eastward you go, the less nobody lives here. This is desert. We are lucky in the States, Mississippi rivers and Rio Grande, from north to south, right? So it's a natural flow of water. So this is, of course, the biggest country in the world who does a lot of manufacturing. Anyway, this place is very interesting to me because this is Bangalore, is in India. And that's the Silicon Valley, larger than our Silicon Valley in California. It's very, very huge. That's where, or when you wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and you can't find your glasses, you call somebody on the phone, or you are lost in the middle of New York City, somebody calls you up and you call those guys from Bangalore. Remember the name, very, very, it's in south of India. Anyway, look at the malls in the world here. I don't know if you see any American malls. Those are the largest malls. This one is a very, very big one. This one is one of the largest malls in the world. And it is their own outside this country. Somebody say, so what? Well, it means something. 15 years ago, we were number one in all those. So anyway, Dongguan, this one, is actually 3 times what we have in Minnesota. So you can comprehend the size of this. The emerging markets, if you can see the emerging markets, which is the biggest companies, the largest 10 companies, 5 of them are emerging market. Emerging market is actually kind of new developing markets, which is Asian markets or BRIC countries. I have to mention here the multinationals, which is the next word, multinationals. They are in Brazil, which is a group happy now. Okay. So anyway, so they are alone. We're not there. England's not there. France is not there. And the reason I had this small star there or whatever, because I want to mention this guy, Antoine Van Engel. This guy, gentleman, who decided what is emerging market would be. Emerging market is a market where, oops, sorry. This is yours or mine?
That's mine.
Oh.
Can I
Okay, we'll fix it up. Don't worry about it. It's not. It's on YouTube, are you sure? You want to change your mind?
Not yet.
Anyway, Mr.
Oh, for sure.
You're going to be on YouTube too?
Okay, good luck. Okay, anyway, that gentleman there, he's the one decided that any country has a GDP per cap less than 10,000 would be an emerging market. So emerging market is very new market, it's very exciting, where everybody can sell products and so on. Now we're going to go to the bad stories. Okay, you guys know where's that, right? Big Apple, okay, this one? 40 seconds, it used to be a fun stream. But anyway, I'm not going to get into this. It used to be, but not anymore. If you are old enough, you know what I'm talking about. Your 40 Second Street used to be a very nice place. Now, this is the one in Dubai. Look how fancy it is, just underground. This is New York City, Broadway. Wall Street, that's what actually leads it to 111 Wall Street, which is our New York Stock Exchange. That's the metro in Dubai. That's the subway we have in New York. That's the subway in Shanghai. China. This one is actually in Bethesda, Maryland. And the problem here that, as you see, we have a lot of problems here. The problem is sometimes we see things, but we don't say anything about it. So the idea is, if you see something wrong, say it. Because otherwise you'll get used to it, and then you're not going to talk about it. Everybody's used to it. I live in the San Juan, and I take Second Street. And Second Street, you need a four-wheel drive. So one time I wanted to talk to the mayor, I said, please, fix the road. First Street is lovely. Third Street is lovely. But Second Street, my street is bad. Anyway, this is the Beijing, which is the southern part of China. This center is two million square foot. They built the center in 8 months. 8 months. And remember the sign for the city hall? I don't want to remind you, nobody's doing anything about it. So anyway, 8 months they built it. Actually, they're thinking of moving part of Davos and have the conference here because it's a very huge building, very beautiful there. This is a mega airport in Dubai. They have 8 runways of this big airplane. It's called A380. I don't know if you ever heard about it. But the 380 is our 747. Two times. Okay, that's the way it looks like inside. I mean, that's not first class, that's all classes. I like that. Okay, anyway, now we go to the serious business. The America, I know, are the one here. Some of you agree with me, some of you don't agree with me. But that's the one I know when I came 35, 37 years ago. Especially this one. It's very, very important. The America now is this. Or this. Red room?
Yeah.
Okay. Or this, actually. Well, definitely, we have a problem with the value decline. We have depreciation of values. If you watch hearing, I'm from Virginia, by the way, so for us, the Congress, the Senate, the President is our neighbor. So we for you guys, it's somebody far away, but for us, we make sure that we have a best President and best Senate and so on, because they are my neighbors. So anyway, there was a hearing a couple of years back. I don't know if you recall. There were two different hearings. One of them for baseball players, they've been taking steroids. And 5 years later, or 5 years ago, actually 2009 to be specific, we had the problem with the Wall Street bankers. Me, I'm a banker originally. We had this CDS. Anybody from my students know what CDS is? Oh, point taken from you. Okay, credit default swaps. So they were sitting and they had a hearing in the Congress about this, in the Capitol Hill, about what they have done. I can see very much similarity between the two. The two were not very honest, right? So what they're doing is instead of building muscles and becoming strong, they're injecting steroids. Our generations, or maybe probably older too, they had a very hard time. They had heart depression. They had the war, they brought victory to the war in different continents. They believed in saving and investing and sustaining values instead of just eating all our savings and investments. And that's what the new guys do. So I feel that there's a loss of pioneering spirits. The pioneers, the spirit that has gone out. People used to look at America, that our one of the greatest nations on earth. They looked up to us, you know, they landed on the moon. And we were the exceptional, and that's what I'm trying to find out from my presentation today, how to go back to where we were. So we moved from here. You all know those guys, right? Okay. 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 Well, there was some reasons for it, you know. There are causes for this slow motion decline we had. One of the things happened that we misread the Cold War. When was the Cold War started? Anybody remember? 1954? When is the Russia? Well, the old man, sick man of Russia died. When Berlin Wall okay, 1989. So actually, this is one of the Russian guys said after the 1989, the Berlin Wall was down. He said that I'm going to do terrible things to you guys. I'm going to deprive you from an enemy, which was Russia. He's a very famous expert in the U.S. relationship with Russia. He's right. When you have an enemy, you relax, right? So one of the other reasons too, when the wall fall down, then we have globalization start coming up. Suddenly we have 2 million people working, new workforce coming in, from China, from India, from Brazil, from many, many people, and the world became flat. And we have, if you are living in Boston or Bangkok or Bangalore, which is, you know, now Bangalore, it became the same city. Everybody can see everybody. Mumbai, Manhattan, or by the way, they have almost 18 million people living in Mumbai, in India, so it's not a lot. Or Manhattan or Moscow, that became neighbors. Everybody, once the wall in Europe fall down, then you can see your neighbors. Now it's becoming globalized, and everybody wants everything. All those guys from India and China, they all want American style life. They want two-car garage. They want very offensive thing. Also, we were hit by the same time by the IT revolution, because a lot of jobs actually went outside America because of the revolution. I mean, what happens in the IT? I'll give you examples shortly. Well, somebody was in the Air Force was actually, they do this a lot in Air Force. If you have dogfight, they have something called ODA, and ODA stands for, you have to, when you fight two planes, fighters, you have to observe and you orient yourself and decide what you want to do and attack. That's it. Well, now we have different acronym for our life in America. That's what the politicians do. SAGP instead of order. So they shout, they scream to each other, each one fights for about what is dependent. They divide each other, now we are very much divided. And they postpone decisions. Oh, you hear that? Obama did that recently? Oh, this postponing any decisions for later, right? The problem we had with the deficit. Okay, so everybody in the world has to be very, very fast. And you have to, the speed of world is very, it does matter. I was in China and I went to one of the ninth year celebration of one of my friend's university. So I saw them making a big festivity. I said, what's this confetti for? Wait, why don't you wait one more year to 10th anniversary or the 25th anniversary? They said, oh, no. We know we're going to be in the 10th and we're going to be 20 and 50 and 100. He said, we don't want to, we are like racing with you. We don't want to reach where you are. He at least admits that they are not reaching us yet. But he said, we would reach you and we would surpass you. We would just pass you. So all that speed is very, very important. Anyway, 20 years of problems we have. Some of the problems, issues, I think. Education is the standard of living. The standard of education is, except my students, you're all good, you're learning excellent education. Don't worry about it.
Okay, because you're finance. I mean, come on, you get a shot. So anyway, so now the whole world became like a classroom, one global classroom. So the global curve is going up. You're competing with everybody else in this world now. One of the problems too, deficit. Oh gosh, we have a chronic problem with deficit. I mean, state level, federal level, the budget, huge deficit where I came from in Washington, D.C. And the state has mentioned commitment they cannot fulfill. I mean, there's a lot of problems at both levels. Energy climates, I mean, that's we have a lot of continuously looking at burning fuel, you know, for because it's an easy source of running your car, but it's not good. So you can see that in the green effect. So basically, we kind of stopped thinking of the our traditional formula of being greatness, and then nobody sacrificed except me with my students. I was sacrificed for that, but nobody else sacrificed, right? So anyway, so we're not able to fix the problems or reinvest it because we have the system is again the shouting and screaming and me better than you incentives are given. Politicians looking their incentives maybe on how to they want to gain votes, right? Our incentives, you and I, not to survive, right? We want to just to make sure what to do what's right. So we're both fighting different incentives. So we do need a strategy to fix these problems. One of the main things is to adapt to global change. Adaptation is number one. Okay, it's not the strongest species that survive, nor the most intelligent that survives. It is the one that is most adaptable to change. Life is constant change, and you have to, the more, all the way from, okay, that's my partners in pitbulls, pitbull partner, we have a lot of pitbulls. So this is very simple. So look at the changes happen, what happens there. So if you have a Boeing jet line, Boeing aircraft, you're getting the part from, part of the parts from Moscow, from Russia. You're getting the wings from China. You're getting electronic panel from our neighbor, Kansas, from Ajika. In this world, there are 30% of the 7 billion people living in the whole world are actually using internet. So marketing, they use cloud engineering. You buy anything from online from anywhere. Amazon using it. You can sell anywhere, you can buy anything anywhere. So the notation of export now is not really a matter of fact. It is within US, within China, within the world. You can make anything anywhere, any place in the world. So somebody said, why the urgency? Why? Actually, my wife asked me this question. She said, why are you in a hurry to do it? Because actually, in 2000s, we spent a lot of time fighting terrorism. For instance, Thomas Friedman, who wrote the book The World is Flat, said very interesting comments in his book. He said, 10 years after 2001, people are not going to go back and think of September 11. They were more focused on December 8th, because December 8th, where China joined the WTO, World Trade Organization. So we were focusing on this, and actually, the real enemy was the December 8th, not September 11th. So anyway, sometimes you feel like you're driving without on empty gas. Something happened these days, which is my wife is witnessing that all Virginians and most of the eastern state have been, they had 7 different snowstorms, major snowstorms, just recently. And they're really running out of money. They're running out of salt sometimes. They're all announced that they are emergency, so they can get funds from the government. But still, everybody's running out of money. So, and that's the danger, is that something can happen in a natural disaster, which is, we'll be paralyzed. We're not going to be able to help ourselves with it. And by the way, you all know that California droughts, 2/3 of the crop, this recently, is going to affect us. And that's what I'm worried about, that something drastic can happen and we don't have money to pay. That's why the urgency. Anyway, Churchill, God bless his soul, he said, America always do the right thing, but only after exhausting all other options, do be right. But we don't have time to choose options, but the right ones, actually. This is just to show you how is the globalization is affecting you. We are right here now, we have almost 7.4 billion people. In 2050, it will be 9.2. So there are 2 billion people more coming up in this world, all need gas, all need the fuel, all need the 2 cars. So we are competing with, and by the way, most of these 2 billion, not from Europe or from America, they are all from Asia and from Brazil. So anyway, here's my guess, the one to talk about. There are a lot of flattening forces happening in this world, some of them, as I said, the collapse of the old man, which is called Russia. We moved from what they used to call it the connected to hyper-connected the world. There's a very famous Nepal. Nepal is a smaller town in Asia. They did 3G and now they have 4G. So they used to give those to the kids going to Mount Everest. So can you imagine you're sitting up in Mount Everest and talking to your mom saying, hey mom, guess what I mean, what I'm saying now. So, I mean, that's 28,000. We have 14,000 here. There is a school actually in Iowa called the Grinnell College, small art school. 800 of those guys are from China, and they have excellence. They have very good records, set records. So Chinese are coming to here. We are competing. Very famous school, high school in China called the PS21 in Shanghai. We're competing with them. Very big university in Moscow called the Tolstoy, and we're also competing with that. We have a problem in the workforce. We have to, what the students need to learn. They need to learn how to be practical, how to be part of the GDP and the economy. We want to, students who really look at the labor economics, that's a science by itself, as you all know. But anyway, we want to find somebody who knows how to problem solve and critical thinkers. I always tell my students that forget about all these complicated finance equations. Forget about everything. The only thing you can learn or you can leave from Adams is just the way of thinking. The bank or the institution you work in can teach you everything, but nobody can teach you the way to critical thinkers, to be a critical thinker. Routine skills jobs is not there anymore. Nobody cares about. If your job could be automized, you know, automatization, or outsourced by somebody else outside this country, or robotized, you can get a robot to do it, or digitized, you're gonna lose it. So you don't have a chance. So routine jobs are not there. So the summary is that you have to work very hard. Some of the signs for help wanted I've seen. You can do the old work in a new way, or a new work in a new way as well. If you have homework, this is to my favorite, lovely students. Homework is not enough to do it once or twice or three times, because you are competing with a school, universal school. Everybody else, there's one only piece of a pie. If you can get it, somebody from Moscow will get it, because the world is flat. So, Woody Allen, remember, he said, they said, oh, you can go to work and 90% is okay. No, it doesn't work. In an interview, you have to be really critical thinking. Everybody's having a lot of people asking for jobs, but the only people, creative creators, people selective, who does get the good jobs. You have to, one of my family members is a lawyer, and they were telling me that when they hire a new lawyer these days, and they work on real estate property management and so on, they don't want somebody to know how to file documents and put it together. They are looking for somebody who knows how to read more documents from Obama, for instance, and sense that you can use solar panel and you can get more tax deduction. You can't just be a lawyer, you can't just be a teacher, you can't just be any type of worker. You have to do a lot of added value. You have to reinvent your job. You have to re-engineer your job.
Nobody's going to give you a job just like that. You have to keep creating jobs. If lawyers change, we should change. Anyway, long time ago, the best good example is Bethesda Steel, which was in the Bethlehem Steel, which is in Maryland. 50 years ago, it's a beautiful facility. You can get a job. If you are a mediocre job, you can get a job. So everybody will get a job. Now it's not the case. Now Bethesda's gone. Do you guys know Maryland? Anybody knows who replaced Bethesda? Now the factory's gone. It's not there. It's a huge piece of land now. Actually, they have a lot of hospitals, and John Hopkins are working here replacing them. So John Hopkins, state of the art technology, Bethesda's gone. Bethlehem Steel is gone. Right? So the old job you used to have is not anymore there. I know some of you may like it, may not, but you need to be like an immigrant, and I'm one of them actually, although I've been here for 35 years, 36 years. Immigrant is, we always drive for success. We cannot take one thing for happiness and that's it. We have to work extra time, extra time. We have always to prove ourselves. Because maybe where we came from, life was not easy, and you don't have insurance. I never heard that if you stop working for you can get the government pay you for 6 months. I mean, that's nothing where I came from. So you have to be also artisan. That means when you do something, you need, it's something you're willing to put YZ, what Yusri Zaro in it. You have to make sure that you're willing to put your initial in it. So that means you really do a good job in it. But anyway, this is the logo here. That average is officially over. You gotta find the extras in yourself. You gotta find what are you good at. And do go from there. But average person, the one who used to work in Bethlehem Steel, not there anymore. Okay. So the deficit is a really problem for me too. Cheney said that Reagan proved that deficit does not exist. Okay, maybe. Well, again, Reagan, if you remember, he was the one who was doing the supply curve, which is economics 101, would know about it. So I don't know how much he knows about economics, but he probably did. But anyway, that's not true, because surplus minus deficit equals zero. So if you move deficit to the other side, surplus is equal to deficit. So if you have Japanese have deficit, surplus, we have deficit, so we can balance each other. Well, this is an old-fashioned way, because Reagan was right in this sense, but what is wrong, that if your deficit is too large, then it could cause a major problem, which it is in our case now. So Social Security and Medicare, you have to adjust it because we can't afford it. You have to collect waste, tax margin, tax rate, close all the loopholes there, energy tax, probably solution. The historic formula we have, that we're spending more money in more in education, infrastructure, and R&D, and research and development. But the other problem is in climate change. Some people believe, 50% don't believe that climate change is right. There's no green effects. There is nothing happening. I mean, it is true. Okay. One of the political system, the problem we have is that the Democrats and Republicans are very much far apart from each other. Many have not been like that over the last, maybe I would say, maybe 100 years. And that could cause problems, because in the dictionary of political science, you could read that this is maybe causing all this, which is what you have, of course. There's no way to fix it. The two parties cannot cooperate together, because each one working for their people. Okay? They're not working for us. Their incentives, as I said, is different. Okay? They don't care about dollar amount. Margaret Thatcher was in, Great Britain used to be called Great Britain in the United Kingdom. They were controlling all the Far East Asia's oceans. Thatcher came in, and Brown, he was the ex-chancellor at the time for her. They decided they didn't have money to be dominant in the Far East Asia, where Garcia, this Air Force base we have there. So they decided to let go of the whole thing. Who took their place? We did. So but maybe it's time for us to think of something else. I don't know. But anyway, so my solution is something like we can do some therapy, some kind of shock therapy, you know, shock therapy. So we need to go back to the formula, the simple formula of American formula, which is, by the way, is not complicated, very simple. So the American formula, I can, the best people can present the formula are those guys. My favorite, actually, I love them all, but this guy is very nice. Yeah. This guy, he was not the president, by the way. They're all presidents, right? This guy, all presidents, except him. He was the one who started the economic system in this country. He is the one, Alexander Hamilton, he was actually working as a secretary of treasury Washington, General Washington. And he was a very, very strong man. He was had the system of economics in this country. He started the first political party. He started the first banking systems. He did a lot of people. He decided to go for limited government, which is, of course, you can tell which political party he started, right? The Federalists. But this time here, you know what he's, him and there's somebody, another gentleman, they, both of them has their money in, I don't know my wallet here. Do you know where is he, what the dollar bill is he, Alexander Hamilton?
Dollar.
Which one?
Ten.
The ten, okay. Another one is Ben Franklin. Do you know which one is? The 100, right. So this guy, really, he's not a president, but I wish he was a president, but he was not. Anyway, each one of those presidents, they've done a lot of good things, a lot of great things. The guy where I came from, I live very close to Charlottesville, Virginia, and I always go visit him, which is Thomas Jefferson. Of course, he's the one who made the University of Virginia, as you're going to know later, but he's also the one who had decided the K-12 education go to the state level, which is a lot of big thing. Look how beautiful they are. They're all, this guy made a tremendous job. Eisenhower, he came to Arbon because he visited Germany. He made those big freeways. You all know Anaheim in California and the first freeways and so on. So this guy has started the whole thing. And Johnson, he was like us, he was a teacher, right? Lyndon Johnson, yeah, you know that? He was a high school teacher. He's the only teacher, you know, for a while. So anyway, the shock therapy, which is the five pillars kind of maybe thinking about, is what makes us great. So we go back to it, simple. So education, instead of looking at arithmetic, read and write and arithmetic, you need to look at the three most important thing in life, in getting jobs. How to communicate well, how to think, critical thinking, and how to build up your skills. You know, that's very, very important. Well, the other thing is the infrastructure has to be improved. Yeah? You get a lot of jobs. Immigration, this is countries that was built on immigration, so maybe it's time to change the policy a little bit. We have to fund more R&D, regulations. And also we need to distinguish between absolute decline and at a global scale. If you say I'm better than China, well, China GDP per capita is around 4,000. We are almost 14,000. So you're going to have always to compare relativity, you know, when you do this type of things. Well, the strategy is to, we want to be, we used to be number one, and we can get back. We have to continue to improve. One of the ideas, I'm not saying mine, I'm not saying I'm going for Mayor Bloomberg next time. But anyway, having a third party may be an idea. I'm not saying it is true, but then we have less incentives and more technocrats in the governments. And do what is right, not do what is those people telling me to do and those people telling me to do. Ross Perot is actually, at one point, he got 40%, by the way, of the vote. He ended having 20%. But Ross Perot made Bill Clinton become going to surplus rather than deficit. He pushed the government so much that when Bill Clinton left the government, we had in 2000, we had a surplus. So his agenda was pretty good. A lot of people liked him. Of course, he was weird. You know, he was thinking almost there's a plane flying over him or something. He was a weird guy. But anyway, so We don't live in a parallel universe, you know, with different rules and different incentives. It's the old say about the moving the cheese or not moving the cheese. We need to move the cheese. It's Newton apple did not come from Newton to the tree. The apple did not come from Newton to the tree, but actually fall down, which called gravity. And we are in the science building. So we have to admit facts. You have to move the cheese. Okay, anyway, that's not far away from where I live in Virginia. And so when you take the picture, took a picture about this, this is Thomas Jefferson, who was
prison number five?
All right. Okay. So TJ, he said, I'm the author of Declaration of Independence. Before he died, he told people to that's what his tombstone should be saying. Okay, fine. Check yours on this. And he also did the American Independence of Virginia. That's definitely Virginia, fine. But he also mentioned something, the father of UVA, University of Virginia. He missed one thing. He was the president number three. Because he didn't want to say what the people gave him. He wants to mention what he gave to them. And by the way, he did it when he was very old, and he didn't have a piece of this. The land was not his. He borrowed it from, shall I say, another president, James Madison. Who's president of that?
Four, five?
Four. Five, James Monroe, actually. James Monroe is number five. And he's actually, when he was a little kid, this TJ, his father, his name is Peter, and he told him, I need to live in that mountains, which is called Monticello. You know? So his father decided to do that. But anyway, but he was kind of relatively not very rich. So. He, from James Monroe, which is the fifth president, he borrowed, or he actually gave him away this piece of land called University of Virginia. It's a beautiful structure, that's it. This is, of course, not the University of Virginia, but this is his. He's one of the presidents, only president, well, you know, you have many of them in Washington, but that's in his Washington. And he looks like a rotunda because he's an architect. Because he was our ambassador to France, so he built. He knows all this beautiful building. That's the University of Virginia, and they call this rotunda. We had a major fire here, and one of the professors like myself, chemistry professor, oh, we're in chemistry building. No, anyway, he thought he cannot fire against this fire, so it turned out to be that fire took all over this building, which was, by the way, that's where the classrooms are downstairs, that's where the library is in the rotunda. So anyway, great man, this guy. So I wanted to go back to the old stuff. I want to go back to the Erie Canal, which is, how cool is this canal? If you ever take this tour, I mean, it's a lovely tour. It Hudson River is right there in New York City, and it connects it all the way to the Great Lakes. Look at that, how beautiful, and Canada. So how nice it is. 600 feet. Thanks for coming, guys. And they have 36 locks. 36 locks. Beautiful hydraulic systems. I'm very proud of it. So my great hopes that we are still the best in management, in marketing, design, shareholders, we have a lot of money still. We can save, invest, and focus on sustainable values. And we have to act collectively to the polarization of politics. It's not going to, the gap is getting too big for me. And the decline, continuous decline in value. We have to go back to our own back moral and all these things. Maybe it's collective actions. Some people think it's like a war or something, but it has to have a measure because everybody else running with a speed of 150 miles per hour, we're running a speed of 30 or 40. So we have to really jump. We probably have an agenda which is hybrid. It means cost-benefit, basically. I mean, you can, you know, the old saying still exists. Live as a like a Republican, like a Democrat. We want to have more of those guys. Apple is a great company. iPod is only 2003. iPhone 2007. iPad 2010. Only within almost 10 years or 15 years, the revenue is $200 billion. Okay? And they created, only 12 years actually, they created the smartphone and the tablet markets. We want something like that. Market cap, I said, what's market cap again? Oh no, it's not a class. Sorry. So anyway, market cap, price of share type, number of shares, just for finance students, if you forgot, $0.5 trillion in 12 years. Apple, who is the Apple's made Apple, the guy who made Apple?
Jobs.
You know, when he started this, after 2 years being in his job, his boss came to him and said, Steve, come in. He said, Mr. Jobs, you have no jobs. I said, what? I don't have jobs. So he was fired. And then 3 years back later, they brought him back and said, our Macintosh is very bulky and silly looking. Why don't you make us something beautiful and slim? And that's when they started making all these beautiful Apple products. Half of the employees of Apple, by the way, were not born in the US. And many of them can be PhDs. So again, globalization. They have 400,000 applications. That's what we need. We need somebody like that. You guys heard about this Instagram? Yeah? Okay. Well, remember, Kodak is multi-billion dollar business, has almost 150,000 employees. There's two guys here, Kevin Sistrom and Mike Eger. By the way, Mike Eger is Brazilian. They met together in San Francisco and decided to have a company where they can share photographs and videos and so on. They put them in the multimedia, they put them in YouTube, they put them in Twitter and Facebook. So they started in 2010. In 2012, 2 years later, Facebook bought them for $1 billion. That's what we need creativity. So to summarize it, to overcome the problems, the challenges we have, we need to adapt to globalization, we need to adjust to the IT technology revolution, we need to cope with this budget, find a solution for it. If we can spend it, we don't have the money, don't spend it. We have to go back to the greats, to what made us great, invest in the future. Those are my references, but this is what I need to be. We want to be there. Okay? Right. That's it. For any questions, but not from my students, no. Non-finance problems, questions. Yes, sir.
So how do you define global dominance, and why is it a goal that we should pursue?
Well, in my mind, the global dominance is to reach the train, the fast train, the older train of other countries. They're running very, very fast. And we have to get there and show them that we are good in R&D, we are good in innovation, we can fix our political systems, because they watch us, trust me. I mean, the news all over, in America, news all over all the other countries. And to show them that we're really strong enough, we have to work together, we have to focus on science and technology and finance, and that's what makes us dominant again in the world. They know we were there one day, and they know we will be there. And they love our student living style. They want to be like us. So they would be very disappointed if we cannot run as fast as they want, but they are. We have to run fast.
So we should do this not to disappoint other countries? I mean, what?
That's the second part of my question.
Why is dominance important? I mean,
very good, thank you. One of the slides I showed that maybe there's a global strategy you can do. Maybe dominance, may not be the solution. I agree. But we were there. We are 310 million people living in this beautiful country. We can do it. We have a lot of, I'm in the finance field. I mean, I can read and read and read and read. There's so much smart people in this country. So much. Mm-hmm. We have so much energy. We have so much gas and oil and so on. So I think the world wants us to be dominant. Let's put it this way. Coming from the other side of the world and living in Far East Asia and Europe for a long time, they wouldn't want us to dominate the world. Everybody wants somebody to tell them what to do. And we are the one who can tell them about it. I'm not saying being patriotic or anything. Truly, we can tell them what to do. And everybody wants a teacher to tell them or tell her what to do. So people are looking up to us to be a leader. And they felt that we are kind of
chipping away a little bit. They want us to come back and prove that.
Well, I have a vested interest in science and education. You know, I agree with you across the board there. But I'm not sure that increasing the GDP or keeping up with everybody else is going to make anybody happier. Oh. The depression rates in the United States are second highest in the world, just behind France.
Well, you know,
France and the United
you,
States aren't exactly poor countries, even if they're falling behind.
What happened in 2007 and 2008 when the Federal Reserve, or the, actually most of the banks in Europe, got together over a weekend, they never meet in a weekend, to solve the problem of what we have with the investment bankers. We have five in 2007, beginning of 2007. End of 2007, we had no investment bankers. So Bear Stearns started in March, followed by Lehman Brothers, and so on. So when the problem started in America, the credit crisis in America, it went across the border very fast. It affected the whole world. It's like throwing a rock in a lake on a lake. And so the whole thing spread very fast, very, very fast. You can't imagine. We are the dynamic force in the world. I mean, take it or not, believe it or not, it's a responsibility what we have. And I think everybody's looking up for us. They're looking up for us, not for our music, not for our movies. No, no, they look up for us to make something right, for our Apple, for our Instagram, and for being creative. And we have the strongest force in the world anyway. How long we're going to maintain that, that's something to be negotiable. But definitely, I can feel, and I can tell you, talk to many of my friends in Europe, and Far East and Middle East, they are all want a powerful person to guide them which way to go. So I think we should be strong. I'm not sure I agree with the president very much that let go a lot. I think we have to show a strong army, but we also have to show a strong us from the side. We have to solve all these issues first. So there's a lot of job for the new president to come. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Oh, sorry, frankly, sorry.
Okay. Question. We're declining nations, is what you're saying right now.
Correct.
Let's say we continue on as a declining nation. We lose our position as the number one in the world. How does this affect the American lifestyle? It's going to change us. So what's going to happen? What are we going to lose?
That's why we need the third party.
Well, give me an idea. I mean,
well, the world is not going to wait for us until they will be happy. I mean, some of them will be delighted to see us going down, because they would say, hey, you know, China for once, or Russia, or the BRIC countries, they would be happy to see us down politically. But people themselves living in these countries, they don't want us down. They're still looking at us up. So we want to capitalize on this. Definitely the standard of living will go down, but we have to do something drastic. I mean, I'm not saying drastic by changing the whole, I'm just, do homework more. I mean, do the simpler things, which is, I know we can. Don't you know, there's a pictures taking, all my students, they laugh at me because I work a lot, including a lot of hours. And the other day, one of the students who graduated working in a local bank, he said, Professor Zaro, guess what time I left work yesterday? I left at 8 o'clock after the janitor said, what? He is like me. So we have to teach people to work hard, and then we'll reach there. I mean, I grant you that the standard of living will decline for a while, but by working hard, we can recoup what we have lost. Definitely. Those presidents I showed you, and Alexander, those guys, they are from here. So we are good. We just need somebody to bring us back to the founding fathers, the true American.
We're in a momentum of decline. Every great nation goes into, historically, Rome falls, Great Britain no longer, the sun sets, you know. It's every great nation slides. And their living style is adjusted. Usually it's more expensive, you don't have the same goods, you don't have the same resources that you had when you are controlling the world, essentially, is what this nation is doing.
Frankly, I can honestly tell you from my heart, we will never decline. I know civilization, the only civilization is have declined and went back, came back. The Roman went decline one time. Oh. The only civilization came back again was pharaohs, you know, the Egyptians, you know, went up and down, 1,000 years in a dip, 200 years and then 1,000 years in a dip. Now they are still in long dip. But anyway, but we know we're going to decline because our ground, our basics are good. Well, those are all fighters. Those people came from...
So
but there is a lot of cushion under us to give us ammunition to be strong beginners. There are a lot of smart people, there are a lot of people willing to work. We just have to insert this in them, each one with their kids, each one with their family, each one with their employees, with their with everybody you see in our group or in my group. I mean, we have power. I don't think we can decline that easy. The world cannot function without us. The G20 cannot function without America. We still are the planners. We still have decide what to do and what not to do. There may be some fine tuning we need to do. I agree with you 100%. But we have a lot of good things saved in the history.
I agree, but I still think where we are right now, political system, we're heading this way.
Well, but political system, if power is what you give to these people, so if you don't give them much power, we give them the power, right? So why 4 years, maybe 2 years? I mean, there's somebody might shake the ground there. And as I said, you know, living in Virginia is very different than living in Colorado or California. You really feel part of the system somehow. I don't know how to explain it, but it is true. So we have to be very strong with our politicians and make sure that we do what is right to do, like Great Britain did in Far East Asia. They could not do it. The Exchequer, you know, Brown, said, I can't do it. So they let go. So we have to face reality. But don't worry, Frankie, we have a lot of cushion down there. Trust me. Is somebody optimistic for a change?
I know him just on a social basis, so I don't know what he really teaches in class. But I'm also a foreigner who came here. And the one thing that he mentioned is that you as Americans, and me as an American now, what I love about it is that we can communicate.
I'm an immigrant too.
Okay, great. And what is good about it, I think, is that we can communicate. You guys, the American people, led me into your colleges. And taught me, wow, a foreign little, you know, Mexican, you know, Hispanic kid that in here got to go to the universities. I can pick up a phone now, I can call, in my specialties that I do, I can pick up the phone and call whoever writes an article somewhere of something new and say, hey, Joe, I saw your article. How the heck do you do that? That's not clear. And he, calls me back later on with more information. That communication doesn't happen in other countries, okay? And that is what is going to make, you know, either you communicate among yourself and keep this country growing, or you just build walls and say, oh no, they're going to take my patent away. Ooh, if I tell this buddy over here who's a professor about my article that I'm going to write, he's going to beat me to it. If we start keeping it, then you're going to be like the Chinese, you know, scientists who are competing against each other and then hiding information one from the other. The American system, the beautiful thing about it is the communication that you can, and if we, you know, do that, I think that you have a chance of staying up on top. You can blow it. You can blow it another way.
Thanks, Carlos. Carlos, a good pit bull there. And his wife too, she's great. Any other questions?
The world's economy is based on the strength of the American dollar. Chatter on the internet lately has been that we're going to, in the near future, not be dominant. Our dollar's not going to be used anymore. The Chinese yuan's going to take over. They're going to buy their oil with that set of American dollars, and the American economy is going to crash.
ROW, rest of the world, are getting very smart as far as that's concerned. A lot of politicians who knows a lot of finance. in Europe, mainly. Adam Smith came from there, Ricardo came from there. So they know what they're doing. What happened actually, if the dollar goes down further, there would be, we might have go down to 70% devaluation almost. And that would be one of the largest devaluation ever happened to our currency. And if that happened, people in the world would use a basket of currency. They use, as you kindly said, the Chinese yuan, they're going to use the South Korean yuan. They use the Japanese yen, sterling pound, they probably use the euro too, and have a basket of currency. Actually, we are encouraging it, to be honest with you. I talked to some friends of mine who are up in Washington and this, and they mentioned that they like that. Because they like it, because if we are so much, they are so much dependent on the dollar, we like to have a little bit free movement of our dollar. So we don't mind it at all to have a basket of currency with other currencies. It's not going to affect us. The world trade business now is becoming, as I said, is very, very global, very easy to do business. So I don't think it's a problem. The only problem is for my student, because they like to do arbitrage and work between different currencies. So if we have one dominant currency in the world, then they're not going to play the game of arbitrage, which is converting from international finance, converting from one currency to another. You know, we can live with our guys. Okay. Any other questions? Well, I wanted to thank you all for coming. It's been really a pleasure night and a pleasant night, and I hope you have enjoyed it. I sure did, and we will see you hopefully in one lecture sometime.